Please stand. I am the resurrection, and I am life, says the Lord. Whoever has faith in me shall have life, even though he die. And everyone who has life and is committed to me in faith shall not die forever. Let not your hearts be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many rooms. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And when I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you to myself, that where I am, you may be also. I am sure that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. Well, welcome to this service. My name is Phil Bristow, and I will be the interim minister here, beginning next Sunday. This is not the introduction to the parish that I was anticipating. I wish that I'd had some time to note him, because I've heard so many wonderful things about him. Originally, Canon David Lynn was prepared to take the service. However, after we had spoken, and on Friday, he got word that he had a kidney stone which required immediate removal. But I know that he sends his greetings to you, and I'm sure he would prefer to be here. Now, this service is a beautiful service. I'm impressed by how Leslie and the family and the church have put together such a lovely, positive service. It is solemn, but it is not sad. You will find that the note running throughout is an emphasis on life and our eternal hope and our future eternal life that we're looking forward to. So with that in mind, let us begin our service as we sing our opening hymn. It is Praise the Lord, hymn number 384 in your hymn books.
Praise the Lord.
You'll find our service on page 576 in your green books of alternative services in the pews. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Shall we join in praying the collect on page 577? O God, the maker and redeemer of all, grant us with your servant Timothy and all the faithful departed the sure benefits of your Son's saving passion and glorious resurrection, that in the last day, when you gather up all things in Christ, we may with them enjoy the fullness of your promises through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever. Amen. Would you be seated, please, for the readings, and I'll ask each reader just to come forward as it's your turn.
Psalm 139, verses 1 through 5 and 12 through 17. Lord, you have searched me out and known me. You know my sitting down and my rising up. You discern my thoughts from afar. You trace my journeys and my resting places and are acquainted with all my ways. Indeed, there is not a word on my lips, but you, Lord, know it altogether. You press upon me behind and before, and lay your hand upon me. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me. It is so high that I cannot attain to it. For you yourself created my inmost parts. You knit me together in my mother's womb.
All the readings this morning were Tim's choice, who kept his readings in the back of his hymnal years ago. And we found these readings, and so we're glad to share them with you. A reading from St. Paul's letter to the Romans, chapters 8 and chapters 14. I am persuaded that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other created thing shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ our Lord, Christ Jesus our Lord. Whether we live unto the Lord, or whether we die unto the Lord. Whether we live, therefore, or die, we are the Lord's. For to this end Christ died and lived again, that he might be Lord of both the dead and the living. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The second reading is from the book of Revelation, chapters 21, verses 1 to 7. I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth were passed away. And there was no more sea. And I, John, saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down from God out of heaven, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband.
And I heard a great voice out of heaven saying, "Behold, the tabernacle of God is with men, and he will dwell with them, and they shall be his people, and God himself shall be with them and be their God. And God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes, and there shall be no more death, neither sorrow nor crying, neither shall there be any more pain, for the former things are passed away." And he that sat upon the throne said, "Behold, I make all things new." And he said unto me, "Write, for these words are true and faithful." And he said unto me, "It is done. I am Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end. I will give unto them that is athirst of the fountain of the water of life freely. He that overcometh shall inherit all things, and I will be his God, and he shall be my son." This is the word of our Lord.
Thanks be to God. Thank you for those readings. Shall we stand and we'll sing our gradual hymn, "Alleluia, Sing to Jesus." It's hymn 374. Please remain standing for the gospel. The Lord be with you. The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Matthew chapter 5, verses 1 to 16. Glory to you, Lord Jesus Christ. And of course, this is the beginning of Jesus' Sermon on the Mount. When Jesus saw the crowds, he went up the mountain, and after he sat down, his disciples came to him. Then he began to speak and taught them, saying, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they will receive mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called children of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. And blessed are you when people revile you and persecute you and utter all kinds of evil against you falsely on my account. Rejoice and be glad, for your reward is great in heaven. For in the same way they persecuted the prophets who were before you. You are the salt of the earth. But if salt has lost its taste, how can its saltiness be restored? It is no longer good for anything, but is thrown out and trampled underfoot. You are the light of the world. A city built on a hill cannot be hidden. No one, after lighting a lamp, puts it under a bushel basket, but on the lampstand, and it gives light to all in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before others so that they may see your good works and give glory to your Father in heaven." The Gospel of Christ. Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. Please be seated. The choir is going to sing the anthem, "They Shall Soar Like Eagles" by Laura Manzo.
Wow. Good morning. This is crazy. I never imagined I'd be the one standing here today celebrating with you all at my father's funeral. But here we are. And I stand before you truly humbled and overwhelmed by the outpouring of kindness, support, and love over the last few days. Love, that one word that's on repeat. The one thing that binds us all here together today and always. There's no preparation for a moment like this. It arrives suddenly, and we find ourselves in the thick of it. But we work through it. Because as my dad would have said to me, that's just what you do. My emotions may get the best of me yet, so please bear with me. Be patient, and we'll get through this together. Thank you for being here. Thank you for your kind words. I swear the fridge has never been so full. And my parents raised three teenagers. Thank you for surrounding us with your warmth in this great hall. We're all grieving the loss of a beloved man, and that absence weighs heavily on us. I want to do something a little unorthodox for a funeral, but I figure if not now, then when? Look around you. Look to your left. Look to your right. Reach out and take someone's hand. Take a moment to just breathe. Feel each other's presence. And know that my father was surrounded by this very love as he slipped away just a few days ago. It's difficult to condense all of Dad's life into just a few minutes. I mean, just look into the Kennedy tire. That's the name we call the shed. You'll know exactly what I'm talking about. Nonetheless, I hope I can do him justice. The reality is, I know my dad best through my own eyes and my own experiences, but we can't wait to hear all of your stories and memories as well. Dad was about as multifaceted as the Swiss Army knife he always had in his pocket. Talented, clever, athletic, wise, empathetic, handy, welcoming, and warm. He had a unique ability to meet you where you were, to connect with you eye to eye. He never made anyone feel less than, yet somehow he could inspire and encourage you to be at your best, even when you were at your worst. He just understood people. He got it. He saw you. He respected and accepted you exactly as you came. As a younger man, Dad explored a lot of ideas for his future career, bouncing between philosophy and theology, dreaming of becoming a priest in university. Before he found his true passion, teaching. For as long as I can remember, every night around the dinner table, we'd hear stories of his day, the challenges, the worries, and the joys of being a teacher trying to do his best for his students. We also got to hear the successes. And we could see and feel the pride as he shared those stories. My sisters and I never had Dad, thank goodness, as a teacher. Particularly me, as the horror student in the family. So we never experienced him in the classroom, but the feedback we've received from his former students, some dating back to his time at Fitch Street, has been humbling and awe-inspiring. Thank you to all of you who've reached out. Dad, or Mr. Kennedy as you knew him, is so proud of each and every one of you. Dad was a well of knowledge, but he balanced that by being endlessly curious. He was always open-minded, willing to learn, and even willing to stand corrected, sometimes. Of course, like all of us, he went through that know-it-all phase. But as he matured, so too did his ability to admit he was basically just winging it like the rest of us. You know, there's this phrase that keeps coming up among my sisters and I. Silent pride. Dad was always the first to lend a hand, even if he was clueless as to how to tackle the problem. He was always willing to figure it out. This very organ behind me, for example, Dad and Bill Outred repaired patiently, meticulously, and one could say cluelessly, in order to save the church a few much-needed dollars. Once Dad offered to help, he never backed out. It might have taken him a while, but he always delivered. And if anyone still has any outstanding work from him, call Tom Lannan. Dad did everything with authenticity, never boastful, never seeking praise. Whatever he did, he gave it his whole heart. He swelled with pride inwardly, and anything more than a simple thanks or a handshake would embarrass him. He helped because, here it is again, that's just what you do. That's the kind of man he was. If Dad wasn't refining the art of puttering around in the workshop, shoveling the driveway or fixing something at the church, you could probably find him in one of three places over the past 15 to 20 years. Singing with a choir, at the rink, or on the golf course. I didn't fully realize, and I'm still learning, how important singing was to Dad. It became one of his most meaningful pastimes, and I'm not sure it was just about the singing. The deep and profound friendships that blossomed through joining choirs meant so much to him. Our family shares Dad's love of music. My sisters are both talented musicians, pianist, flutist, and vocalist. Mom also sings beautifully as an alto in the church choir and the troublemakers. I myself play guitar and sing whenever I get the chance. So music has woven this tapestry through our family. It brings joy, it soothes pain, it bridges divides, and brings us together. It's fitting, really, given how much music meant to Dad. He truly loved singing, and with his sense of humor, he adoringly dubbed his choir the Harbor Lights, the Harbor Frights, especially after tackling particularly difficult pieces. And thank you to so many of you who are singing here today. On the ice or at the rink is where Dad truly came to life. He was a brilliant skater, fast, smooth, and effortless. His love of hockey was undeniable, but what made it even more special was how much he loved watching his grandsons develop their own passion for the game. He was always there, cheering them on, offering support, and just beaming with pride. That passion for sport wasn't anything new. It started long before with us kids. Dad rarely missed a game, whether it was mine or my sister's. He coached our baseball and basketball teams. He tried his best to teach all three of us to golf. Admittedly, Dana was the only one who showed any real talent, but Dad never cared about that. He was there for the fun, for the bonding, for the sheer joy of being together. It's not to say he didn't get competitive. When you played against him, especially in golf, it was basically everyone for themselves. It was like psychological warfare. One of Dad's favorite things to do was to play these mind games. He'd make a comment right when you were about to make a putt or right after you'd hit the putt, and he'd stand back and say, "That's not going in." It would totally throw you off, but what made it better was when he'd go ahead and three-putt the green. Golf wasn't just a game for him, though. It was about spending time with his buddies, taking trips together, sharing laughs, and just enjoying life. Dad had a knack for making everything a little more fun. One of his quirks was creating trophies, these wonderfully ridiculous creative trophies. He'd find a reason to make one for anything and everything, and they were always over the top in the best possible way. If you ever received one of them, hang on to it dearly, because it's a little piece of him. Outside of sports, Dad was a deeply dedicated husband to my mom. His love for her was unwavering. Every morning, without fail, he'd kiss her goodbye before heading to work. And when it came to taking care of our home, he was tireless. Whether it was renovating a room to give us all some much-needed space, or fixing something that had broken, Dad did it all. Often muttering under his breath and cursing, but always doing it with love. He wanted to create a home for us, and he did just that. Well, my parents did just that. And then there was Kennedy Tire, as I mentioned before, the legendary shed. If you needed a random part, a tool, or something obscure, Dad usually had it. The shed was packed with all sorts of odds and ends, and somehow he knew exactly where everything was. It was his little kingdom of treasures. In the coming days, I know we'll discover more pieces of him tucked away in every corner. Finally, I want to thank you all once again for the outpouring of love and support you showed Dad at the end of his life. He was always humble, always appreciative, and every single message, visit, and kind word truly touched him. In those final weeks and days, he came to fully understand and accept the profound impact he'd made on all of our lives. And he embraced that realization. Each prayer moved him to tears, and he was endlessly thankful for the love and blessings bestowed upon him. My dad loved deeply and without hesitation. He cared about everyone and listened to what they had to say. I implore you once again, choose kindness, choose decency, choose love always. Thank you.
Wow. Thank you, Patrick.
That was beautiful, Patrick. Thank you. I'm sure I speak for everyone. I never met your dad, of course. And even more, after those words, I wish I had. I'd have loved going golfing with him, because that's one of my passions as well. Unfortunately, if we'd watched hockey together, we might not have been that compatible. First of all, I'm not that great a skater, but I'm from Montreal. Was it his brother Joe who played for the Toronto Maple Leafs? And so the lines would have been drawn. On September 17th, 2018, National Public Radio in the U.S. broadcast a TED Talk by Lux Narayan, who is the CEO and co-founder of a social media intelligence company. And he called his talk, "What Do Obituaries Teach Us About Lives Well Lived?" Over a 20-month period, Narayan and his employees studied 2,000 obituaries from the New York Times. And they were looking for some common threads that wove them together. They were surprised that the most common word in obituaries was the word help. For example, there was Rick Curry, who helped veterans and disabled people by running writing and acting workshops for them. And Jocelyn Cooper, who was a grassroots organizer in Brooklyn in the 1960s, and she helped pave the way for the first African-American woman to sit in the US Congress. And then there's Tim Kennedy's obituary in Davidson Funeral Home's website. It says, Tim was a lifelong devoted member of St. James and St. Brendan's Anglican Church, where he found great purpose in serving the congregation and took immense pride in maintaining the church he so dearly loved. As Patrick has already said, he was always the first to lend a hand, whether loading up his pickup truck or fixing something for a neighbor or a friend. Help. I'm sorry not to have known him. Canon Lynn knew Tim very well. Before he took ill, he told me that he stayed with the Kennedys when he was the interim priest in charge here before Reverend Silk came. And their kindness and their hospitality made them lifelong friends. Tim's faith was important to him, and I could tell that right away when I saw the beautiful service that they've put together. The Christ-centered hymns and the music and the really powerful Bible readings. Psalm 139 is one of my favorite psalms. It's attributed to King David, and it reads like a prayer, but was probably meant to be sung as a hymn about God's intimate knowledge and his relationship with us. We are intimately known. You created my inmost being. You knit me together in my mother's womb. We are purposefully made. I praise you because I'm fearfully and wonderfully made. We live in eternity. All the days ordained for me were written in your book before one of them came to be. And in the Revelation chapter 21, John of Patmos was given a glimpse of eternity. I saw a new heaven and a new earth. I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, look, God's dwelling place is now among the people, and he will dwell with them. They will be his people, and God himself will be with them and be their God. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes. There will be no more death, or mourning, or crying, or pain. For the old order of things has passed away. John Donne, who may have had these words in mind in 1609 when he wrote his famous sonnet, Be Not Proud, Death Be Not Proud. Donne was an Anglican priest, and not long after he was ordained, he suffered a major illness that brought him close to death. Possibly it was typhoid fever. And he survived, and during his convalescence, he penned these immortal words. Death, be not proud, though some have called thee mighty and dreadful, for thou art not so. For those whom thou think'st thou dost overthrow, die not, poor death. Nor yet canst thou kill me. From rest and sleep, which but thy pictures be, much pleasure then from thee much more must flow. And soonst our best men with thee do go, rest of their bones and soul's delivery. Thou art slave to fate, chance, kings, and desperate men, and dost with poison, war, and sickness dwell. And poppy or charms can make us sleep as well, and better than thy stroke. Why swell'st thou then? One short sleep past, we wake eternally, and death shall be no more. Death, thou shalt die. Was really captured in the words of the Beatitudes, the beginning of Jesus' Sermon on the Mount. How blessed we are in every aspect of life, for God is with us. And he will comfort us, he will meet our every need, we are never alone. And the promises of Scripture, his love of God, his hope in Jesus gave him meaning in his life, and he has now claimed those promises as his inheritance. Can you hear him saying with the Apostle Paul, neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future nor any powers, neither height nor depth nor anything else in all creation has separated me from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus my Lord. Amen. Tim rests in peace, and he will rise at the resurrection in the last day. That we know. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the people gathered here today. Thank you for Tim's marvelous family. Pour your blessing upon them. Give them your comfort. May they know your peace, which passes all understanding, a peace that flows from the truth of the gospel and the presence of Jesus in our lives and our hope for our life to come. We pray in the name of Jesus. Amen. So let us stand, and I'd like you to join with me as we confess our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. It's on page 578 in your books. Let us confess the faith of our baptism as we say, I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please kneel or be seated as we continue with the prayers of the people.
We've all said many prayers over the last while for my little brother, Tim. Let's join our hearts and minds and souls together as we pray the prayers of the people. And after I say a sentence, the answer will be, hear us, O Lord. Hear us, Lord, because we believe that God does hear us. So let us pray. Almighty God, you have knit your chosen people together in one communion, in the mystical body of your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Give to your whole church in heaven and on earth your light and your peace.
Hear us, Lord.
May all who've been baptized into Christ's death and resurrection die to sin and rise to newness of life. And may we with him pass through the grave and gate of death to our joyful resurrection.
Hear us, Lord.
Grant to us who are still in our pilgrimage and who walk as yet by faith, that your Holy Spirit may lead us in holiness and righteousness all our days.
Hear us, Lord.
Grant to your faithful people pardon and peace, that we may be cleansed from all our sins and serve you with a quiet mind.
Hear us, Lord.
Grant to all who mourn, especially Leslie, Dana, Patrick, and Ashley and their families, and all of Tim's family and friends. Grant to all of us who mourn a sure confidence in your loving care, that casting all their sorrow on you, they may know the consolation of your love.
Hear us, Lord.
Give courage and faith to those who are bereaved, that they may have strength to meet the days ahead in the comfort of holy and certain hope, and in the joyful expectation of eternal life with those they love.
Hear us, Lord.
Grant us grace to entrust Timothy Leroy Kennedy to your never-failing love, which sustained him throughout this life. Receive him into the arms of your mercy and remember him according to the favor you bear for your people.
Hear us, Lord.
Amen.
Amen. The peace of the Lord be always with you. And I invite you to share a sign of the peace or a hug with those immediately close to you. We won't go across the aisles, but peace of Christ be with you. Peace of Christ be with you. Peace of Christ be with you, Catherine. God bless you. Peace of Christ be with you. Good to see you, Bernice. Peace of Christ be with you. Our service continues on page 580 with the celebration of the Eucharist. God of mercy, accept the worship we offer you this day. Increase, we pray, our faith, deepen our love, and confirm us in your eternal love. Deepen our hope and confirm us in your eternal love. We ask this in the name of Jesus Christ the Lord.
Amen. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. Blessed are you, gracious God, creator of heaven and earth. We give you thanks and praise through Jesus Christ our Lord, whose victorious rising from the dead has given us the hope of resurrection and the promise of eternal life. Therefore, with angels and archangels, and with all who have served you in every age, we raise our voices to proclaim the glory of your name. Sitting or kneeling, let us continue in prayer. We give thanks to you, Lord our God, for the goodness and love you have made known to us in creation. In calling Israel to be your people, in your word spoken through the prophets, and above all in the word made flesh, Jesus your Son. For in these last days, you sent him to be incarnate from the Virgin Mary, to be the Savior and Redeemer of the world. In him, you have delivered us from evil and made us worthy to stand before you. In him, you have brought us out of error into truth, out of sin into righteousness, out of death into life. On the night he was handed over to suffering and death, a death he freely accepted, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, Father, according to his command, we remember his death, we proclaim his resurrection, we await his coming in glory, and we offer our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving to you, Lord of all, presenting to you from your creation this bread and this wine. We pray you, gracious God, to send your Holy Spirit upon these gifts, that they may be the sacrament of the body of Christ and his blood of the new covenant. Unite us to your Son and his sacrifice, that we, made acceptable in him, may be sanctified by the Holy Spirit. In the fullness of time, reconcile all things and make them new, and bring us to that city of light where you dwell with all your sons and daughters, through Jesus Christ our Lord, the firstborn of all creation, the head of the church, and the author of our salvation. By whom and with whom and in whom, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory are yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. And as our Savior has taught us, let us pray. The gifts of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. You're all welcome to receive Holy Communion here today, following the family and the choir. If some of you are not able to handle the stairs, then let a sides person know and we'll be glad to come down and bring communion to you. And if for some reason you don't feel comfortable receiving the sacrament, come forward for a blessing, and I'll be glad to say a blessing upon you. If you're not comfortable receiving from the common cup, I just ask you to touch the base of the chalice, and that will be your blessing for you. The gifts of God for the people of God.
And his comfort resting upon you today. Amen. The body of Christ. The Lord bless and keep you. May the Holy Spirit draw close to you, and may you feel the presence of Jesus with you today. Amen. The body of Christ. Broken for you. The body of Christ. Broken for you. The body body of Christ broken for you. The body of Christ broken for you. The body of Christ broken for you. The body of Christ broken for you. And the Lord bless and keep you. May you feel the Holy Spirit resting upon you and bringing you comfort this day in Jesus' name. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord's presence be with you and may you feel the Holy Spirit giving you comfort today in Jesus' name. Body of Christ broken for you.
Yeah.
Jesus is resting with you and upon you today and always. Is resting upon you today and always. Amen. God bless. The body of Christ broken for you. 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 The body of Christ. Thank you. body of Christ broken for you. The 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 body of Christ broken for you. See why things fall over.
Thank you for that beautiful music during communion. Lovely. Our service continues on page 585 in your green books of alternative services. Let's bow our heads in prayer. Almighty God, we thank you that in your great love you have fed us with the spiritual food and drink of the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ, and have given us a foretaste of your heavenly banquet. Grant that this sacrament may be to us a comfort in affliction and a pledge of our inheritance in that kingdom where there is no death, neither sorrow nor crying, but fullness of joy with all your saints, through Jesus Christ our Savior. Amen. And shall we pray this together? Give rest, O Christ, to your servants with your saints, where sorrow and pain are no more, neither sighing, but life everlasting. You only are immortal, the creator and maker of all, and we are mortal, formed to the earth, and to earth shall we return. For so did you ordain when you created me, saying, you are dust, and to dust you shall return. All of us go down to the dust, yet even at the grave we make our song, Alleluia, Alleluia, Alleluia. Give rest, O Christ, to your servants with your saints, where sorrow and pain are no more, neither sighing, but life everlasting. Into your hands, O merciful Savior, we commend your servant, Timothy. Acknowledge, we pray, a sheep of your own flock, a fold, a lamb of your own flock, a sinner of your own redeeming. Receive him into the arms of your mercy, into the blessed rest of everlasting peace, and into the glorious company of the saints in light. Amen. And the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be amongst you and remain with you always. Amen. Our closing hymn is hymn number 381, Praise My Soul, the King of Heaven.
His hands he gently
Lord, now lettest thou thy servant depart in peace, according to thy word. For thine eyes have seen thy salvation, which thou hast prepared in the presence of all people, a light to lighten the Gentiles, and the glory of your people Israel. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and shall be forever. Amen. I should have mentioned that you're all welcome to a reception over in the Guildhall later on. Thank you all for coming. Full service. Oh. Oh, no.